we expect to be able to mobilize investments of up to 4.6 billion euros. And we need also to cut the cost of broadband rollout. A study we are releasing today shows that 110 billion euros a year could be generated, more than 0.5% of GDP, if the internal market for electronic communications were completed. So this European Council should be, we never know, but should be with less drama than the usual last summit. I'm sure you will agree, a little less drama will do no one any harm.
Thank you very much, President. The first question fielded comes from Europa Press. Juan, go ahead.
Juan Saner Melando, de la Agencia Española Europa Press. En español, por favor, presidente. El gobierno español está pidiendo a la Comisión Europea una mayor flexibilidad para cumplir el objetivo de déficit para 2012, teniendo en cuenta el desvío del año anterior y la mala previsión de crecimiento, y quiere que este tema se aborde en la cumbre. Me gustaría saber si usted es partidario de dar a España más tiempo para recortar el déficit, o si, por el contrario, la Comisión se plantea sancionar a España si en el presupuesto de 2012 no incluye suficientes medidas para recortar el déficit. Gracias.
On these concrete issues, I prefer to answer in English. The reality regarding Spain is that we do not yet have a full picture of Spain's fiscal slippage last year and the reasons for that slippage. We expect to have this information in March. We are still waiting for Spain to present its budget for 2012, this year, which Prime Minister Rajoy has said will be presented by the end of March. So only then, when we receive the concrete information, we'll be able to take a position on the issues you've mentioned. In any case, I trust that this budget will be fully in line with the Stability and Growth Pact rules.
Thank you very much. The next on my list is Alain Franco.
Oui, bonjour, Monsieur le Président. Je suis là. Bonjour. Deux questions, si vous le permettez. Ce matin, Jean-Claude Juncker demande dans une interview à la Libre Belgique qu'il y ait un commissaire européen dédié à la reconstruction de la Grèce. Je voudrais savoir si vous pensez que c'est une bonne idée, et si oui, quel commissaire devrait prendre le job. Deuxièmement, à propos du nouveau traité, est-ce que vous êtes préoccupé par la question de la ratification, étant entendu par exemple que l'Irlande donc veut faire un référendum, et puis la France aussi, qui est quand même un des pays à la base de ce traité, un des pays instigateurs, qui pourrait changer un peu de paradigme, puis changer de majorité. Et s'il y a un changement de majorité, François Hollande a dit qu'il voudrait renégocier le traité avant de le ratifier. Est-ce que ça vous préoccupe? Est-ce que ce serait même un problème, compte tenu quand même qu'une bonne partie de ce qu'il y a dans ce traité est déjà dans le six-pack, etc. Merci.
Vous me posez beaucoup de questions conditionnelles. Bon, tout d'abord, concernant l'organisation de la Commission dans le cas grec, je crois qu'au moins pour le moment, nous avons tout l'avantage à mettre ensemble le programme d'ajustement avec les mesures d'appui aux réformes. C'est pourquoi j'ai créé une task force qui dépend directement du commissaire vice-président pour l'économie et les finances et pour l'euro, et aussi de moi-même. Moi, j'accompagne directement ce travail parce que je crois que nous devons mettre ensemble les différentes compétences. Le programme que la Grèce vient d'adopter, son gouvernement et son parlement, ce n'est pas simplement un programme de consolidation budgétaire, c'est un très ambitieux programme de réforme structurelle. Et c'est pourquoi nous devons avoir d'un point de vue de management de la Commission, une approche aussi intégrée que possible, au moins dans cette phase initiale, après l'adoption de ce nouveau programme. Et donc la task force qui a été créée par la Grèce travaillera directement sous l'orientation du vice-président pour l'euro, parce que c'est une des principales tâches que nous avons, c'est d'aider la Grèce. Ce sont des réformes faites par la Grèce elle-même. Ce n'est pas un commissaire qui va résoudre les problèmes de la Grèce, c'est la Grèce elle-même. Mais nous devons aider cet effort d'une façon aussi intégrée que possible. Après, avec l'exécution du programme, on verra. Tout cela, c'est évidemment du travail qui doit être fine-tuned en fonction des résultats. La deuxième question, c'était sur le référendum en Irlande. 25 États membres vont signer le traité. C'est à eux de décider comment ils veulent maintenant le ratifier. C'est une question intérieure, je ne fais aucun commentaire là-dessus. Ce que je peux dire, c'est qu'évidemment, je soutiens ce qu'a dit hier le Premier ministre irlandais, Enda Kenny, quand il a dit que la ratification du traité renforcerait la confiance dans la relance de l'économie de l'Irlande. Et j'aimerais bien sûr appuyer très clairement ces commentaires. Moi, je crois aussi que ce traité est très clairement dans l'intérêt de l'Irlande, mais c'est bien sûr une question pour le peuple irlandais à décider, puisqu'ils ont décidé de faire un référendum.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Je crois que vous avez peut-être anticipé la prochaine question, but I give Arthur Beasley the floor anyway, since he asked for it and continues to ask for it. Arthur?
On that note, Mr. President, what do you say to suggestions that the calling of the referendum will make it easier now for the Irish government to secure a concession from its European partners under which it would reduce the cost of the very onerous bank rescue in Ireland? In other words, a quid pro quo. Thank you.
I already said that the way the member states ratify the agreements they sign, it's an internal matter. I will not have any further comment on that.
Thank you, President. Daniel Rosario.
Question in Portuguese, if you don't mind. Daniel Rosario, Rádio Renascença, Jornal Expresso. Senhor Presidente, a Troika esteve ontem em Lisboa e apresentou as conclusões da terceira missão sobre a implementação do programa de ajustamento português, numa altura em que as previsões da própria Troika, numa altura em que estamos a chegar quase ao fim do primeiro ano de aplicação desse programa, as previsões da própria Troika em relação ao crescimento da economia e em relação ao aumento do desemprego são bastante mais negativas do que aquilo que era esperado pela própria Troika. Não obstante, a conclusão é que a implementação do programa está no bom caminho. Não é um pouco paradoxal tirar esta conclusão face a esta evolução da situação? E, se me permite, uma segunda questão relacionada com o Conselho Europeu que começa amanhã. Concorda com o adiamento da discussão sobre o reforço do fundo de resgate do euro? Pensa que a situação já não o justifica ou pensa que a Europa está a falhar na sua parte do acordo, uma vez que, por exemplo, Portugal está a cumprir a sua parte ao implementar um programa e a Europa adia uma questão que pode lançar nova incerteza e instabilidade nos mercados? Obrigado.
So, since I answered to our Spanish friend in English, I'm going to answer also in English to our Portuguese friend to show how objective we are. As you know, the Troika concluded just yesterday that the Portuguese program is on track, and I warmly welcome this assessment. Indeed, Portugal is making steady progress in very challenging circumstances. Important structural reforms are being implemented. Long-standing problems are being addressed, not least in the labor market. And in the labor market, I'm especially pleased with the fact that there was an agreement between social partners and the government. So we in the Commission believe that the capacity of Portugal to generate growth and jobs is being enhanced. And this is also the opinion of the European Central Bank and the IMF, as you can see from the Troika report. There are already very encouraging signs, namely the reduction of the external imbalance. This is not to deny the difficulties that many people are now facing in Portugal, but we believe the program is the only way forward that can give back to Portugal the competitiveness Portugal needs. There is no alternative. So we are going to continue to support Portugal implementing the program as fully and effectively as possible. Regarding what you call the apparent contradiction, there is no apparent contradiction. Portugal is on track in terms of the implementation of the reforms. And the downward revision of the GDP of Portugal is also a result of the downward revision of growth expectations in the euro area as a whole. So this difference in the growth projections and growth forecasts, as you know, are not Portuguese specific. Regarding the second question you have put on the firewalls, as you remember, the commitment of the euro area heads of state and government last December was to reassess the adequacy of the overall lending capacity of the FSF and the ESM in March. We are still in February. Tomorrow is the 1st of March. There are 31 days in the month, and I expect this issue will be addressed later in March, well before the date of the G20 IMF meetings. I think that issue should be addressed before that, and that will be in April.
Thank you. Thomas Weingartner.
Basically, this was my question, but what is the position of the Commission in this, on this matter? I mean, is the Commission for increasing the firepower, or do you think it is sufficient?
The Commission, since the beginning, has made clear its position. In fact, when most of were not agreeing with us, that we need a reinforced firepower in Europe. For firewalls in terms of protection for the financial stability of the euro area. We have said it from beginning, not only the increase, but also the flexibility. Now we believe we can do it, but we are still in February, and I think we can have a good progress on this matter later.
Okay, thank you very much. The lady here had asked for the floor. I don't know if you still want it. Yes. Go ahead. For you. Yes.
Tatiana Aleksic, B92 Belgrade. Question for President Barroso. Having in mind yesterday's recommendation of the ministers, and you met with Serbian president yesterday, do you think that Belgrade had done enough and should, with optimism, waiting for European Council on Friday and the decision about candidate status?
Look, I can speak on behalf of the Commission. We have already proposed several months ago to grant candidate status to Serbia. Serbia deserves the candidate status. The candidate status because Serbia has delivered on the commitments that we have asked Serbia to accept. So from our point of view, from the Commission point of view, the European Council should endorse this candidate status to Serbia. Now, what decision will be? It depends on the member states. As you know, it's a decision that requires unanimity. And yesterday, I spoke I received here President Tadic, as you know. I also spoke on the phone with the President of Romania, with Mr. Bazescu.
Thank you very much. Yes, go ahead.
TV channel Russia, are you going to discuss the situation in Belarus at tomorrow's summit? Do you believe that the recent recall of all 27 ambassadors from Minsk is an adequate measure? Is it a temporary measure? And on what conditions can they return to Belarus?
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. Polish question in the back. Yes, go ahead. Inga, go ahead.